The Hymers from Otley in Yorkshire are giving up their normal lives to go back in time to the Second World War.
Not a tear, make it gay.
Michael, an engineer, his wife, Lynn, their 29-year-old daughter, Kirsty, and grandsons, Benjamin, aged 10, and Thomas, 7, will spend the next 9 weeks living as a family on the home front.
I don't wear dresses, I'm always a trouser person, so different, very different.
Come in then, wherever you are. Oh!
You look lovely.
You don't look the part.
You don't look my two little boys.
Very
pretty. Smart.
It's an emotional moment. Our family are leaving their hometown for the first time.
As I came out of the door, I realised that this was it now, that I couldn't turn back. There were too many people involved and all the wheels had been set in motion. And here we go, for better or worse, as it were.
Thank you, everybody. Mm. Thank you.
This is what I imagine was the hardest thing for the people who lived through the war, people saying goodbye. It must have been so, so hard. If it's going to be like this, it's going to be an emotional roller coaster.
And just wave me goodbye. Cheerio, here I go on my way.
Ben was acting grown up and trying not to let it, you know, bother him, but Thomas did actually get quite upset. I can't even begin to imagine what it must have felt like to, you know, wave your husband off or even wave your children off, but people had to do it.
If this were the summer of 1939, the Hymers would be joining over 2.25 million Britons who were forced to leave home in the first month of war. In West Wickham, on the borders of London and Kent, the Hymers' new home is waiting. It's everything a middle-class home like this would have been. No phone, no car, no central heating. In the 1940s house, life for the Hymers will be strictly controlled. There's a war on, and they're going to feel the impact of a strong government.
Let's start with the big question. How...
In Churchill's war rooms, we've assembled historians and scientists. From now on, they will dictate all aspects of the family's experience.
As the cabinet, we're going to have to say there were regulations, there were rules from authority that governed your life in wartime, and these are going to have to govern your life too. You're not going to be able to have consultation. Rationing is going to affect you. Various emergency powers are going to affect you. And this is how you're going to have to live.
Let's get their neighbours denouncing them to the air raid precautions people. Let's get them fined. Let's see the psychological impact of the war on the home front.
Waiting to meet the family is our consultant, Marguerite Patton. She was a wartime advisor for the Ministry of Food.
Hello. I'm here just to show you into your new home. Can you give this? I say, that's a splendid creature. right. Well, do come in. There we are. Oh, that's wonderful. By the name, my name's Marguerite Patton.
No, we know. You know.
Now, you'll be the first person to go into your new home. There we are. Off you go. To know what you think of it.
Oh,
there you go.
Oh, I'm never going home.
Let's make yourselves comfortable, if you will. Now, the first thing I'm afraid you'll have to think about, blackout curtains. That's a book to read, the things that are important. That is your own siren. That is the one which will warn you of an air raid. And when it sounds, please, and this is terribly important, get moving quickly. I've worked out your first week's menus in 1939. That is a typical menu of what we would have had and cooked for a family.
I've seen chocolate cake, I can't make a cake.
I'm sure you can. No Yorkshire woman that's born who can't make a cake. Am I right? I bet she's good.
I've never known her. For 29 years, I've never known her to bake a cake.
Ah, well, then you'll have to explore the possibilities. I've never seen two ladies look so horrified.
Well, it's been very pleasure to meet you all, so I think we might have to get in touch with you.
Well, I think we've got a splendid family. They're ready to work hard, and by Jove, we worked hard during those years. The family haven't quite the same emotional problems, people in danger and worrying all the time about the news, but they have the other problems of making do. And they've suddenly stepped from a life where they had all their labour-saving appliances to a life where we really didn't have them. We had support from everyone around us, but they're doing it all by themselves.
Which is ours, do you think?
I don't know. This looks like the boys' room.
Is this ours?
Yes, it's ours. It must be. It's twin beds.
Eh? I've always had an interest in the home front during the 40s and often wondered what it would have been like to have lived through that time. So this is a bit of a dream come true, really.
Thank you. Well, you've hit the jackpot.
Yeah. You?
Whether I'll still feel the same in 8 or 9 weeks, I don't know.
I love it.
It won't be too bad. We can move these together.
No, I don't want to. Oh, wonderful. Is this your bedroom?
Yeah. Twin beds.
Yes!
When she's snoring, I'll push her over there.
Oh, look at this. People have said to me that there was a lot of laughter in the war and they had fun and they had good times, but there must have been some damned hard times as well.
There's another corset like the one I've got on.
Things are going to get tougher and I just hope I can cope with it. In fact...
I can't show you them on for obvious reasons.
I'm here because it's a challenge for me. I'm a person that lacks in confidence, so I think it's going to make me a stronger person. And because I live on my own, it's going to make me be able to cope with things better at home.
Oh, this is a nice room, isn't it? Single bed, Kirsty, so you can't have any visitors.
You'll get many GIs in there.
I've got a window, I've got a room that locks. Won't get a GI through there.
Yeah.
Takes you back a bit.
Make me a bad pad. We've got three rabbits.
Are these ones pregnant?
It says. It says youngsters will be ready in approximately 6 to 8 weeks.
Hang on, how many rabbits have we got?
Five
rabbits. And how many? And one of them's with child.
Yeah. Granny, what are we having for tea?
So, this is cooked meat,
eh? Rationing didn't come in until January 1940, so for the first week, the family can enjoy the culinary delights of the day.
The first meal that we had to cook was rissoles. We had to use cold beef and mince it to make these rissoles. And I couldn't bear to put this beautiful beef through the mincer.
because to us, we would have really enjoyed a two-minute meal of cold roast beef. But no, we had to have the 4 hours minced rissoles.
The early war diet was rich in fat and carbohydrate. The average daily intake was 3,000 calories. That's 1,000 more than we usually eat today.
I don't think we'll be having rissoles very often. Now, that's going to take a few days to set on the full marble shell.
There, perfect.
Right. I'm impressed with myself with that. That's the first time I've ever done that.
Having been a full-time working mother for 15 years or so, I relied totally on prepackaged foods or takeaways or restaurant meals. It was just easier because I never had time. The thing with the wartime housewife is she never had time, but she makes time, and that's what I'm going to have to learn to do.
Do you want any green salad?
Did you get this from the vegetable, Adam?
No, I did not today.
And I do it with my hands.
Mum? What? It's absolutely gorgeous. It's gorgeous.
Me too. Compared to what I normally have, the rizzles were really nice. Better than any takeaway, better than anything Granny would get from packets. It was nice. I like homemade meals.
Got some peaches?
Yeah, peaches! Peaches!
Just wait.
Peaches.
Spoon. So if you want to try that blancmange, tell me what it's like.
Ben? Mum's rabbit blancmange is really nice. It was creamy and light, and just it was hardly there. You could hardly feel it when you put it in your mouth. It was just perfect.
This is London. The government have given instructions for the closing of places of entertainment. They are being closed because if they were hit by a bomb, large numbers would be killed or injured. Keep off the street.
The radio will be a vital link to the war years. Every day, the family will receive an hour of original broadcasts.
Carry your gas mask with you always. Make sure that you and every member of your household, especially children able to run about, have on them their names and address clearly written.
It was lovely going to bed in the house because we put our lovely nighties on and we spent another hour doing our putting our curlers in.
How could it take so long to look this ugly?
I mean, celibacy is the order of the day because I don't feel like a woman and Michael didn't fancy his granny, so perhaps at 50 you were done for. You just crawled into your twin bed and died.
Dream a little dream of me.
Terrible problem, these dresses. They're a bit stiff, aren't they?
Are you making a drink?
What?
Are you making a drink? Oh, you're looking beautiful. Do you think it's worth
it? Bears in the bed. What did it all said? Roll over, roll over. So they all roll over.
Michael's taking a break from work, and the boys are on school holidays. They need a couple of weeks to adjust to wartime living. Already, there's a problem with the rabbits.
They're so cute, little bunnies. There's actually two outside to have a little play. There's two shy ones, and there was a mother one that was pregnant.
Rabbit keeping for food.
Yeah, the problem is you're thinking now, look.
Of course we're thinking of now. We're a family from now. The children are being brought up.
Exactly, so now. That's the point.
Every other house where I live has got rabbits in the back garden.
Anna, yeah. Everything you eat, meat-wise, and we are meat eaters.
Yeah. Yeah, but they're not enough. They're not enough. All right, I don't want to put five puppies out there and we stew them.
No, I'm missing the point.
Wait, that's a breeding centre. It's distasteful, it's disgusting, and I can't live with it.
That's how it would have been.
We don't have to discuss it anymore. The rabbits are going today. Even if I had to walk.
I'm not advocating keeping the rabbits at all.
Make signs and pin them all up the street saying, rabbits, come and get them free. Give the address out or whatever. The rabbits are going.
Before the children get too attached to them.
The government was actively encouraging people to keep rabbits for food. Domestic rabbit clubs were springing up all around the country, and people were even offered extra rations of concentrated rabbit food to encourage them to keep and to breed the rabbits.
A lot of people kept rabbits, and then when the crunch came, decided that they couldn't bear to kill them, or I know instances of people actually killing a rabbit and then finding they couldn't eat it, even when it was on the table, and or sitting there eating it with tears streaming down their cheeks. And I think actually this family were rather sensible in anticipating the problem they were going to face when the ghastly moment came of having to kill the rabbit.
Right, let's do the business.
We need some rabbit food.
I wondered if you'd be interested in taking some rabbits off our hands.
How many of them are there?
There's four quite young.
Yeah.
One big rabbit. We're prepared to give you anything we've got to take them. Please take our rabbits.
They sell the rabbits.
Oh, you're upset about that, Tom?
Yes, what? Very.
Well, you're the easy one. Wait till we go tell your brother.
Rabbits were not the only pets to suffer. In the first 4 days of war, 400,000 Londoners had their cats and dogs destroyed. They feared they might not be able to feed them or keep them calm when bombs began to fall.
Sad when the rabbits went, because I got nice and friendly with them, picking them up and cuddling them. They were so cute. We even named them. So sad when they went, because I knew we wouldn't have another rabbit again.
But Benny, why did she want to get rid of them?
It's happily resolved for us all. The rabbits have gone off to a good home. The pet shop man's delighted with his bundles. And the children are happy and we're happy. So, on to the war.
Time shoppers could only use the shops where they were registered. So the Heimers family can only make their purchases at Lovegrove's.
Morning.
Good morning. How are you this morning?
Nigel Lovegrove has taken on the job of being their wartime shopkeeper.
You've got a selection from going all the way around to there.
Right. Here they will spend their weekly housekeeping allowance of £4.10. In today's money, that's £170. This will have to buy everything, from their groceries to materials for their air raid precautions.
The only other thing we need is the blackout material, are you going to?
Well, we've got a choice of several materials. Have you had a chance to measure up the windows at all?
Not accurately, no. Because I've estimated 10 yards for them. Okay.
Basically, they used lining material and made up a frame, stretched the cloth over the frame, and then they would use some rabbit skin glue and some black pigment to make up a size. Have you thought about your tape for taping up your windows at all?
No, that's something we need to do.
So we've got a large tape.
Yeah.
And we've actually got small tape.
Government advice urged the head of each house to consider himself the captain of the ship when planning the protection of the home. With an air raid warden coming to inspect their blackout arrangements, the Heimers are eager to get going. Everyone feared bombs. Early estimates suggested as many as 1 in 25 people in cities might have become a casualty in air raids. Every local authority was supplied with cardboard coffins in readiness. At the same time, many homes in Britain received a DIY shelter named after the minister in charge of air raid precautions.
Anderson shelter. Where'd you like it? Let's see instructions.
Wow, this is what I've been waiting for.
Look,
that is. How to put up your Anderson shelter.
And look what's outside a big lorry.
Yes, check it out, Tom.
For the last month, Michael and the boys have been excited about building a shelter. It's been Michael's dream since boyhood. But he'll have to pay £7 for the pleasure. That's more than his week's earnings. Anderson's were only free to those on low wages.
My dad be so happy. Whether he'll be happy in two or three days when he's trying to build it.
You're full of water and you're sleeping on a sodden blanket.
I don't care, it's what you've always wanted.
Not so very long ago, on reaching home, I found a load of corrugated iron somebody left around. According to instructions of the safe, my worthy skin, the idea was to dig a hole and fit the sections in.
Something I've always wanted to do, build an Anderson shelter.
Keep your fingers out, won't you?
Just to see what was involved and how much work was entailed. That's what I'm trying to do here. Dig it in properly, kit it out, and sleep in it. Must be mad.
So with my pick and shovel, I began to excavate for my shelter at the bottom of the garden. The neighbours gathered around and offered common sense advice, but my replies to some of them were not exactly nice. The ground was just like concrete and the shovel was antique. The pick went through a gas pipe and the gas began to leak. And when I called the plumber, his description was unique for my shelter at the bottom of the garden.
What it is, this, it's supposed to be a big pan of soup, which will last us a couple of days. What it actually is a big pan of grease. When I did the onions, I did them in lard. So when I put all the stock and everything in, and the onions, the lard's just made it this greasy mess. So I thought if I put it outside for a while, it would go cold, and I'd be able to skim the lard off the top. But for some reason, it's not solidifying.
Not used to manual labour.
Just washing my smalls. Well, my smalls, my father's large, you mean how small is that? How small is that? Not very.
Oh, Dad, it's full of stone.
Thomas,
so it's got to be big enough to get Thomas in.
With the excitement of building the shelter, the more pressing job of doing the blackout gets put on hold.
I think somebody needs to write a letter to the ARP to ask if we can postpone tomorrow night's blackout check, because I won't get this done in time.
Well, let's give it another hour. And if you haven't finished the Anderson by then...
You mad bugger.
Oh. One penny to the swear box.
That's it. Catch it before it falls in the hole.
If we've got to dig 5 times more further down this hole, I'll be on my knees in a couple of hours because I just can't do this. And Dad can't do it on his own. He might like to think he can. Thomas, it's not helping with you standing on the bit that I'm trying to dig. This is your fault, Dad.
I'm not even a foot down yet. You've got 4 of them to go. Well, 3.
3 of what, the depth it is now?
Yeah, 3.
You've got to be joking, Dad. Yeah. I can't do this.
Well, I'll do it.
But you'll have a heart attack.
No, I won't.
Yes, you will.
It may take me a while, but I'll do it.
We're not going to be able to do this.
We are.
No, we're not.
We are. You've got to keep up the spirit that made England great. You couldn't just, in the wartime, sit back, posing on a heap of soil like a girly postcard and say, we're not going to be able to do this. We will do it. Skimmed all the fat off it. So disgusting. It's just a mass of salt. Because it was a bacon joint. But they're so salty. So as it's reduced, it's got saltier and saltier. And I have absolutely no idea what to do with it.
Careful, it's hot, Tom.
It's salty.
Good God, Mum. No, don't eat it, children. It'll make them poorly.
What I would say is it's awful.
It's very, very salty. Yeah. It's like drinking, having a mouthwash or whatever you do.
Okay, so it's back to the old standby bread and jam.
Oh, honey.
Sorry about that.
You let your pastry jam.
The blackout stuff is not going to get done.
The shelter is proving a bigger job than expected, and there's another more pressing task.
Okay. It's pointless just putting it up and leaving it on the surface, so it wants doing properly.
When would the Anderson have had to be built by?
I don't know.
You've
got the blackout to finish.
I think you should postpone the blackout till Monday.
I think the blackout should be postponed. When Dad's finished digging in there, he's not one to come in here and start faffing about with the blackout.
I think Michael's panicking a bit now. He's got what he's always wanted. He's got the blackout blinds to do and the Anderson to make, so pressure's back on. And as we keep pointing out to him, he wanted to live in the 1940s, so here he is. We can't realistically dig for several hours because none of us are fit. I would imagine people in 1940 were a lot fitter than we are now.
Many wartime diaries recall how the task of building a shelter helped break down English reserve. For many, it was the first time they got to know their neighbours.
Big house.
Yeah. Using that to pair of hands.
We do really,
don't we? Oh, I'm not doing that for our pair,
have I? Yeah, we'll have a dig.
Yeah.
Right, out. Shall we come through the garage?
Yeah. All right. We'll see you shortly.
I want to go on and call us Wimp.
Wimp? Wait, look how far we've dug.
How can you be called a Wimp digging this lot?
It's not something I would ask strangers to do.
I did feel that we did need help, although I do feel as though it's looked upon now as if we've sort of like cheated in a way. But then again, I'm of the opinion that in the wartime, neighbours would all help each other. I know, okay, the neighbour offered to come in and help my dad dig the hole. I think that's what they would have done in the war. And although he hasn't got an Anderson for us to return the favour and go, you know, build him, we could offer him something else, like perhaps vegetables out of our garden or something. And I'm sure that's what people did.
That's the rhubarb. That's all we've got ready in our garden, three pieces of rhubarb. So I'm hoping we've got some fruit left that I can mix with it, but hey, no, we haven't. So we're having a very small rhubarb crumble with custard and a tray of scones for our neighbours who are kindly helping us dig the Anderson.
What does that mean, Kirsty?
It's just broken into pieces.
It's too dry, it means you need more
water.
Water or butter or lard or something in it.
I can't waste it. It's got to get. I've got to get it right. I mean, every 1940s housewife knew how to make basic pastry.
Everyone in war, the housewife included, was called upon to play their part. To control supplies and distribution, a minister of food was appointed. Lord Woolton was placed in charge of managing the kitchen.
Come in, Tom.
Good evening. It is to you, the housewives of Britain, that I want to talk tonight. We have a job to do together, you and I, an immensely important war job. And I'm going to be very practical and a bit personal too. Now don't tell me that you never waste a thing.
Sod it!
Let me ask you some questions.
Oh God, we've nothing else to eat. I knew this would bloody happen.
What have you done?
What's that? Get out! It's the whole of the tea, the crumble, all the peaches, all our rhubarb out there, allotment.
On the floor?
All our flour, all our sugar, everything gone. Oh, the tarts are going to get it as well!
Oh, it must make you really cross, actually, spending all that time to drop it on the floor.
I was really looking forward to that. Absolutely nothing else for tea.
So is it jam and bread again for tea?
No, because I'm using jam.
Oh, we're going to have for tea because we haven't got anything else.
Ready?
Yeah.
We've dropped the tea.
Right, put the jam or with the flour over. No, because I've used the jam in the tart. It's our favourite.
Don't
I'm just wondering if I can salvage the rhubarb.
You're not picking that up off the floor.
Would you? If you were in war, proper wartime, that's take me all day to prepare.
Oh, no, I'm not eating it off the floor. You can't do this. We're going to have to swap roles.
I can sew.
There may be difficult days ahead of us. Far more difficult than we've seen yet. We shall still need feeding.
Do you want me to clear the floor for you?
No.
Things are going to get tougher, and I just hope I can cope with it. We have to get organised, and especially as things start to go wrong, which I'm sure they will as the war progresses.
Be hungry, I'm sorry.
We're not eating very well because, we're living on bread and jam. The only proper meal that we've had today was probably our Weetabix. That's the only thing apart from bread and jam that we've had. And we nearly had to have bread and jam again because Granny spilled all the food of tea.
Yeah, but she did.
Well, now we've got a casserole which is going to take forever to cook.
And if it
we'll have tea at 9 o'clock at night.
That'd be past my bedtime, wouldn't it?
I want to go home.
I don't want to go home. Well, I do.
Oh, dear.
Concerned that the spring rains will flood the shelter, Michael works on, despite the deadline of a blackout inspection that evening. Kirsty is anxious the War Cabinet may penalise them if they fail.
I think we should fine them, actually, if they contravene blackout regulations. I think the social pressures are absolutely huge. People took the blackout very seriously. They thought that if a chink of light was showing or you lit a cigarette in the street, then you really were likely to bring the German bombs down on that particular area, that particular house. The enforcement of these regulations was draconian.
It's not just a matter of blacking out the windows. They have to make sure that every chink of light is stopped. And 80% of middle-class households during the first weeks of the war failed in this task. So it's a really testing operation.
Is your blackout really black? Can it be detected? Don't keep lying on your back. Go out and inspect it. Is your blackout really black? Have you drawn that curtain? Here's the warden on your track. It's better to be certain. Is your blackout black?
As we're starting to get more and more of the blackout material up at the windows, I am beginning to feel as though we're going to feel trapped in and penned in or whatever, and I don't know how women coped with it.
We've got a warden coming round in an hour and a half.
What time is it now?
Nearly 6 o'clock. And the house is not blacked out sufficiently.
Right.
I think it should be all hands on deck to get it blacked out because...
What, no, I've got to feed the children.
Well, coming up all hands on deck for half an hour. If the house isn't sufficiently blacked out, we're going to get really, really a hefty fine.
Kirsty wants you to come and do a blackout.
I think the three of us should concentrate on the blackout now.
Right. Well, I'll need to get changed.
In half an hour, then, we start blackout, and I'll get the tea on, your father will get changed, which will make it 6:30.
Well, I'll just carry on then and do my best, but it won't all be blacked out. Can you manage?
I don't know.
I don't like it. It looks like a slum. I want to go home. It looks as if we're living in total squalor now. Can't make this pretty. It's just getting darker by the minute. Going out in the garden where it's light.
What time is it?
6:20. It's got an hour and 10 minutes.
It's been a hell of a day and it's all fallen to pieces a bit now. I think Kirsty's had enough. Michael's absolutely exhausted. I've done a load of washing and I'm really tired. I'm concerned about my family's health. My husband particularly is overweight and over 50. And he's had to work harder physically than he's had to work in a lot of years. And we're now waiting for a visit from the ARP lady.
Can you turn the light on, please?
Mm-hmm.
It took months for people to adapt to the claustrophobia blackout prompted in the home. But the fear of attracting bombers made people vigilant. In some cases, neighbours took to stoning the windows of homes that persisted in showing lights.
We haven't had time to do it properly, so we'll probably get a fine. And, oh, that sounds like the Air Raid Patrol. No. So it's icing on the cake time today, really. But, that's what we agreed to, this is what we agreed to do.
Hello.
Hello.
Making the inspection, Patricia Nolden, who at the age of 17 became West Wickham's youngest ARP warden.
I guess we won't be smiling if you fine us.
I don't do the fining.
Oh, right.
But I might put your name forward to the police.
I'm reading one of the books. I made this frame.
Yeah.
So that I can just lift it down during the day and let the light
that's
in.
A
and
good this. Idea. Yes, most important that that's not going to get any light through any chinks, isn't
that
it? Because you need to be up here.
Yeah, that one's permanently painted.
Oh, so that's all right.
This is what I did.
Yeah.
Well, the brown paper sticky stuff.
Yeah.
Well, that looks very efficient. That should be all right, shouldn't it?
It's worthwhile, huh?
Yes.
What have you done about upstairs?
The same as downstairs.
It's the same.
It's the same arrangement in our bedroom.
Yes.
Yes, that's done.
Well, I think you'll get away with it. We will keep an eye on you, of course.
Of course.
The hidden cost of blackout was the lives it lost. With streets also plunged into darkness, there were many tragic accidents. By Christmas 1939, over 4,000 people had died in road accidents, double the number that had occurred in peacetime. It's 10 days since the Heimers moved into the house. Now the War Cabinet have decided to accelerate their experience by advancing events to the start of 1940, 4 months into the war.
Lynn, where are you? Something come through about rationing. You need to fill all the ration books in before you go shopping.
Take the ration books to the shopkeeper. Have we got a ration book?
Got five ration books, you're supposed to have filled them in. Give me crap.
Been busy. This looks incredibly complicated.
I'm sure you can cope with it.
I don't understand it. The children have one for themselves?
Yeah.
So that's mine.
Then this is mine.
But who tells you how much you can have?
The government.
Well, where, how do we find that out?
From your shopkeeper.
On January the 8th, 1940, food rations began.
Rationing was introduced because food was beginning to get scarce, and it was recognised that it was probably only going to get worse, and certainly imports may become more difficult. The war was not going to be over quickly, and it was important to ensure that people had access to all the essential foods, and that there was an even distribution across the country.
Yeah, but rationing, of course, was really popular. I mean, people petitioned the government in favour of rationing, simply because it represented fairness in a people's war.
Is this bad news? Bad news in...
I'm afraid so.
Look at the shelves.
Oh, 1 week. Not a lot left.
Oh my goodness, look at the shelves.
It'll vary, I think, with as time goes on and more things become available, some things will disappear.
I just can't believe it's made so much difference to your shop.
All the vegetables now are basically homegrown, what we can get sourced from our local farms.
Can you see anything else supply. That's missing?
Sweets.
All the sweets have gone.
No, sorry, Thomas.
When will we be able to get sweets again, then?
No idea. What you've got there on that tray, I've measured out to what you're supposed to have
what's
per person.
What about children, Mr. Lovegrove? Is that one adult's rations?
That is one set of rations per book. Unfortunately, along with the rationing, all the prices have jumped up. They've jumped up about 15%. And that's because it's so scarce.
Well, I have to
scarce.
Tell you this. This is the first time I've done a proper list and a proper menu, all costed, and you haven't got any of it.
Unfortunately.
Cornflakes?
No. No cereals at all.
Well, we'd have cereals and more jam and bread.
You'll have to have some nice toast.
There's no jam, Thomas. Baked beans, yes.
Baked beans,
yes.
A few.
Three tins of baked beans then, please.
I'd love to be able to do that, but I've got to...
Oh, they're rationed.
Well, I've got to think about all the other customers as well, so we're sort of putting it out slowly.
So, not only is what we can have rationed, what we really want's not here, and we can only have one of what we don't particularly want.
Well, what's here, you've got to bear in mind, what's here is in short supply as well.
It was a real shock when I walked into the shop. The shelves were more or less completely empty. If that had been a real situation, I think I'd have just burst into tears because it must have been horrendous for them. Unless I'm very inventive, and I'm sure I haven't got the skills that the ladies of the 1940s have, then my family are going to go hungry.
I don't think they're quite ready. Yeah. Sound a bit hard and green to me, but I'll try them.
Bake it now?
Try it. I bet it's bitter.
Ah. If I taste that sour grapes. They're not ready. They're not ready.
There's no OXO. I've got no stock cubes of any kind.
Oh, porridge!
Lynn's options in the kitchen are becoming limited. Without garden produce available, like the wartime housewife, she's having to be inventive to disguise the taste of cheap cuts of meat.
This is leek and porridge oats and mushroom ketchup and Marmite with corned beef. How that will work, I don't know. I have found a pastry recipe from the wartime cookbook, which is a no-fat pastry. I've also seen a recipe for potato pastry, so I'll try both of those tomorrow. Now I know what I've got to do, or I think I do till I get to the shop. Might all change tomorrow.
Meal breakfast.
As shortages increased, meal times became monotonous. It wasn't so much a lack of food, but there was no longer any variety. Their new diet begins to take effect on the Heimers within days.
What food have you missed, Tom?
I'm really, really hungry, because there's really much less food. I think from the other members of the family, they're agreeing with me that there is less food.
The rationing on the food, I'm beginning to find it quite tough. In fact, I get quite emotional about it because the kids are coming to me every sort of hour. I'm hungry, can you give me something to eat? And I can't give them anything to eat because I haven't got anything. The children that are used to snacking in between meals and they can't do that here. What I don't want is the kids to suffer in any way. I mean, at the moment, I don't think they are doing. It's me having to learn to adapt to the idea that I can't always give them what I want.
It's taken a week of hard work, but the shelter is almost complete.
I'm sure we'll all be all right inside here. Once I get it kitted out, we'll make some furniture. Ben will certainly like it. Thomas will like it because he'll see it as an adventure. Kirsty won't like it because she hates spiders and worms and things, and I'm sure there'll be plenty of them inside. And Lynn won't like it because it'll be dark and cold, and she won't be able to do her hair. I probably won't like it either. I don't relish the thought of using a bucket in a 6-foot confined space.
Ben, what's the first thing on the list?
Candles.
As enemy bombers began to target Britain in 1940, people at home were urged to prepare an emergency box. Kept handy by the back door, it was to contain everything you might need should the worst come.
Toilet paper, playing cards,
books. You don't need toilet paper.
Wow.
We're not doing stuff like that, are we?
Well, what happens if you caught short?
No way I'm dumping in a pocket.
You don't know that, do you?
I bloody do. I'd sooner take my chance with the bombs.
Possible. I'll get the toilet paper, Mum.
Just
as the Anderson years completion, I begin to wonder if we'll ever have an evening sat relaxing. We'll never know when we have to get up, pack everything, grab the children and go. We we never know when it's going to go off, which is how people would have been in the war. And we don't actually know when it's ever going to go off. And yeah, I do sit in the back and think, you know, what would I do if the siren went off now? Would I put a towel around me and run out into the garden?
For the last 4 days and nights, London has been living a strange new life. By day, a life interrupted by short warnings and raids, and at night, long hours of waiting in the shelters.
We can take it. If he thinks he can win the war by bombing women and children, he's found a big mistake.
The noise that you hear at the moment is the sound of the air raid siren. I'm standing here just on the steps of St. Martin's in the Field. A searchlight just burst into action off in the distance.
Shelter. I was actually shaking and I managed to put the wrong dressing gown on the wrong child. I went on to autopilot and it was the strangest, most bizarre experience that I've ever had. It was so, so real.
Watch it up, slip.
I felt fear and I felt panic.
Put water bottle down.
All that mattered was to get my family safely into that shelter.
Right. Sorry, it's the candle smell.
What's what? I can't put a chair up in zero space.
Little kids have got up from a deep sleep and you're whinging about where to put your chair.
Bloody whinging.
You wanted to do this. You wanted to step back to 1940.
Yeah, great. I'm not complaining.
I don't. There's a proper leak there in the middle. It's raining a lot, you know.
Well, I haven't sealed it yet, have I?
Of course it hit home, how it must have been for the women who got their family into shelters. And if it shocked me, what must it have been like for those women? My heart goes out to them. I mean, it must have been absolutely horrendous.
People were grateful for their shelters. 57 consecutive nights of bombing occurred in London during the Blitz. And not just on central London. On the night of Friday, the 13th of September 1940, a high explosive bomb landed in Braemar Gardens, destroying the two properties opposite the 1940s house.
I volunteered to do this. I feel terribly guilty. This is my fault. And I am having great difficulty watching my grandchildren almost crying with hunger.
War is really not a good game. It's a lot of hard work, especially for the elders. I wouldn't really like to give up my 2000 life to come back and live in the 1940s because I couldn't cope the whole of my life without food.
I think things are going to get harder. I think we're going to have more and more taken away from us. I find it hard when it's connected to the children. I have to be honest, sat here and thought if I'd done the right thing in, you know, bringing them here.
First occurred last Friday evening when the back door of your property was left open and light left on in the kitchen. That was a bloody air raid. I mean, who cares about lights in the kitchen if your house is going to be bombed?
At a meeting in Churchill's War Rooms in Whitehall, Our wartime cabinet is in session. It's their job to impose the regulations of the day on our family.
This is a major infringement. I mean, a great lighted window that might act as a beacon to German bombers. I mean, given that smokers in the street just striking a match to light a cigarette were prosecuted, so something's got to be done.
It was, of course, just as much an offence to show a light at any time. It didn't have to be during an air raid warning. That perhaps made it particularly bad, but any time after blackout.
I think this is a question of certainly a £3 fine and perhaps a £5 fine at this stage.
It doesn't sound a lot, £3. If your wage was only £8 a week, and that puts it into perspective. It's only a true reflection of what happened, I suppose. You're told what to do a lot more than we are now.
I was really cross about the egg letter because I felt it was very petty. I was just trying to get my children out the house safely. It didn't even occur to me to think that I had to turn all the lights on before I opened the door and get them out in the darkness.
Blackout was dangerous and caused hundreds of thousands of accidents in the home. Just a few streets away, one young mother fell downstairs to her death as she was rushing to comfort her child in the darkness. Families were required to make ever greater sacrifices.
Hey, come on,
like so many husbands, Michael now has to leave. He's returning to work in Yorkshire. For the next few weeks, the women will have to cope on their own.
Darling?
Yes, my turtle dove?
Do you want to test the bunk?
You said, just like this, you were sorry, but I'm just not your Lynn, you said.
It's dark in here, I can pretend. I can close my eyes and think of England. Hello.
You seem as if you're more bothered about leaving your hands in some shelter than us.
Yeah.
My concerns about my dad going tomorrow is the fact that it's just me and my mother and we're going to have to cope with whatever. I mean, I've taken on the responsibility of trying to keep the boiler going. He's given me instructions on that, but I haven't actually yet managed to light the fire in it from scratch. I've just been trying to keep it going.
Right out of the way. The whole thing frightens me. The ash pan is too heavy, full of hot ashes, and I just think it's far too dangerous for us. No, I've read your brother one. I'll read you one tomorrow. Do you want a book getting to read, or are you just going to go to sleep?
Sleep.
I live on my own, so I try not to rely on anybody, but I do know at the end of the day I can call upon my dad if, you know, I've got a problem or whatever. And so can my mum, but she's probably not looking forward to my dad going back.
Rabbit.
See you in the morning. Okay?
Night-night. That's fine.
Night, Tom, night, Ben.
This is nice. Super duper.
Look, well. Got to do their bits. And even our blackout is quite a hit. You'll never see a spot of light around the house at nights. We have no light refreshments now, no matter who invites. And even
Michael works for Precision Engineers making aircraft parts. Doing his bit in wartime would have meant working very long hours.
Can you see it from above?
As if I was a pilot.
Mm. Imagine you're flying over me now.
No.
Industries like aviation were moved to safe areas in the countryside. If their employees didn't move with them, they could be fined or even imprisoned.
Blackout for a cigar. Point proven, I think.
I've lost it.
I bet I could have made a bloody fortune during the war selling these.
But, Dad, it was all a bit of a myth.
Doesn't that's the point, is it? You could get fined for smoking outdoors. Not with the Heimer's patented blackout cigar disguiser.
Good night, sweetheart.
Lynn and Michael were teenage sweethearts. They've been together since she was 14.
Although Michael has been away and we have been separated on many occasions, we've never been out of phone contact. So that's going to be difficult. Very difficult.
That's it then.
Thursday.
Bye, Tom.
Bye, Ben.
Safe journey.
Okay.
See ya. I think it's going to be difficult, you know, just being me and my mother. And
as most people who know us know that we can be at each other, we can disagree quite a bit. I'll be very interested to see whether my daughter and I pull together and manage, or whether we'll pull separately and argue all the time. And I'm very, very apprehensive about it, very.
It's going out. It's going out. I need to shut that as well. It's going out, so I'm just going to have to let it go out, and then I'm going to have to empty it all out again. Try again. Put loads of sticks and I've got a real blaze going. As soon as I put the stuff on, it just goes out. If I don't get this boiler working, then I won't be able to wash up without boiling a kettle.
I'm going to stay here.
I definitely won't be able to have a bath. The children won't be able to have a bath. I'm not going to let it beat me. Even if I stay all night.
When they go out shopping, the women never know what they're going to find. On top of the shortages, there was soaring inflation. From 1939 to 1943, the cost of living rose by 83%.
Good morning, Mr. Lovegrove. This is looking a bit more interesting, a bit more full.
Lovely,
it's war over and nobody's told us.
To save wartime Britain from the prospect of starvation, the Americans began to send vital food supplies.
We've got dried milk and also dried eggs. Dozen eggs, I think, equivalent to per box.
Many of these foods were processed to make the most of precious shipping space.
Spam. That basically stands for specially pressed American meats.
Now, this is where the new system of points rationing comes in.
That's right. The points system really allowed far more choice and flexibility in the range of foods that housewives could choose to buy. It was also a very clever system because by increasing the number of points you needed to purchase a particular food, government could discourage you from buying those foods which were in short supply, and by dropping the points could increase the likelihood of you purchasing those they had plenty of.
Yes, and it made it look as though there was more on the shelves when in fact the shortages were getting worse.
That's right, and from now on in, I think the family are going to have a pretty tough time of it.
We've actually written up the points on the products. For example, tin fruits, 8 points. Golden syrup, 4 points.
The weekly points allocation was 5 points per person, and 5 points didn't get you very much.
Peas, 4 points.
I can see the sense of the points. It would be to stop people who have money buying up all the decent things in the shop, you know, so I suppose it was a fair thing so that everybody had the chance to buy certain goods. I can't understand why tin foods like 12 points, and I'm really miffed to find out why raisins and currants are sort of like 16 points, because every recipe I seem to come across for baking, you know, has raisins or currants in it.
So basically it's got even more complicated. I now not only have to sort out the rations, which goodness knows I've only just got used to, sort of. I've now got to sort out the points system, all this stuff that's coming from America that I can only have every so often, and all this without a calculator.
It's taken Lynn and Kirsty almost an hour to do their shopping. With wartime queues, it usually took 4 times as long, and often housewives returned empty-handed.
Total war demands that all the strength of the nation shall be hurled against the enemy.
When my grandpa's away at work, I feel there needs to be another person in charge, another man, and I am the oldest male when my grandpa's away, and I am responsible.
the battle for fuel. It is a battle on the home front in which every man, woman and child in the country must play a part and do their duty. What you need are battle orders. In your papers this morning, you will see a message from the Minister of Fuel and Power.
I've never had a battle before.
Oh, well, it's exciting, isn't it?
Dear Ben, I'm writing to you as one of the Wartime House War Cabinet about the fuel savings campaign.
Ben has been given the job of fuel warden. From the tables in the papers, he has to calculate the family fuel target, the recommended allowance for a household their size.
Something that was widely recommended was putting a plimsoll line round the inside of a bath to save hot water. You need to run 5 inches of water into the bath, mark where it comes up to, and paint a line all around. Oops, it's on my hand.
Waterproof paint.
Ben's household tips. Never open a can of paint with tweezers. Or, a point for the factory owners, don't fill it to full. That's why. This needs to have a basic line going all the way around. As I've made a bit of a mess around here and put two lines, I'm going to write on the back of the bath, bottom line only.
Well, what waste and sinful greed only make you thinner. One gas ring is all you need when you cook your dinner. Gas the children calling mom.
Because it was very hot yesterday, the milk's actually not very good, it's just about sour. The children won't drink it, we can't use it for cereal. I don't want to waste the milk, I don't want to throw it away. But it can't be used in anything else other than a sauce. I've also got some cheese that's gone a little bit mouldy, which under normal circumstances at home I would have thrown away. But now I can make this sort of rancid style cheese sauce.
Granny, hello? How long till tea time?
Pardon?
How long till tea time?
Dunno. To take things out when they're ready. I'm not following any recipes, so I can't give you time. Why do you want to spoil it?
Being hungry is awful. Your stomach has this awful feeling of turning around inside you. It's a horrible feeling. And your throat completely dries up and you can hardly speak.
Granny, how many minutes?
Two. I'm the man of the house and I say it's going to be 2 minutes.
We're the men of the house.
You're not a man of the house. I'm a man of the house. You're a child of the house.
I'm a boy of the house. Wimp of the house.
I'm not. Mummy Ben just owed me the wimp of the house.
Ben! You come in the kitchen?
Keen to stick to their wartime regime, the children volunteered to take packed lunches to school. But there's been a problem.
Is this all you had?
Yes.
You haven't had anything else?
Yeah, there are my own sandwiches that I had.
And you've had your apple?
Yes.
And your flapjack?
Yes.
And your jam tart?
Yes.
And nothing else?
Nope.
Benjamin?
Nothing else out of my lunchbox.
Have you been eating other people's sandwiches?
Yes.
How many?
Half a butter sandwich and half of a ham sandwich.
I can't have people thinking that you're not getting enough food.
But I am getting enough food.
You'll have to leave it with me and I will sort it out.
I should send your brother in now because he's got to tell Mummy.
Yes.
You think that's a bad wait for this one?
Thomas! Have you had your sandwiches today at school?
Yeah.
All of them?
Yeah.
Good.
Why?
Have you had anything else?
Yeah.
What?
A packet of crisps. Two packets.
Two packets of crisps?
Where have you got 2 packets of crisps from?
These friends.
So you've got friends coming into school bringing you things? I'm going to have to sort something out.
I don't know what junk it is, but I'm sure it's
nutritious. I'm going to have to sort something out, Mum. I'm not having people at their school thinking that I'm not giving my kids enough food and sending their kids in with extra food.
To stop the children eating their friends' packed lunches, Kirsty uses our precious rations to bake the boys a cake.
The rationing is starting to bite quite hard, and we are finding that there's a pecking order almost with the food. I'm certainly drinking more water and less tea or coffee so that the children can have the milk. Sweet ration, I think it's 2 ounces a week per person. We don't touch the sweets at all, the children have it. If we're lucky enough to be able to make a cake, Kirsty and I don't touch it at all.
Did I have any
paper? You're just messing about with that, Tom.
Yes.
Can't waste paper like that.
You know?
No, you can't. It's a law, actually.
Is it?
Yes.
If you've eaten that chocolate, I will absolutely hit the roof.
Kirsty, I was hungry.
Have you eaten some chocolate cake?
Just a little.
Mum, I'll really go mad if you have. That's what I'm...
Have you?
I'm not allowed to
this
eat anything.
This cake I've made for the children. But I know, and everything's for the children, I understand that. But there comes a point where I have to eat more than just dried bread.
I know I've hit a bit of a raw nerve with this business about being so tight over the food, but...
Do you mean tight? I mean, it's just unbelievable. It's like parent abuse. I'm not allowed to eat anything.
You can have my milk ration.
You say that.
I won't have any milk.
I can have the biggest cigarette ration and then you smoke mine.
You're wrong. I am not smoking your cigarettes. I am smoking my Woodbines out of that
bag. Well, I wish your father was here because he would back me up on this.
I think you're being unfair. I said don't eat the chocolate cake. I'm not stopping you from having anything else.
Put a smidgen of butter on my bread and you stood over my shoulder. Is that butter?
Hang on. My priority is my kids get enough to eat.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm going out without things.
Yeah, but it goes down the line, doesn't it? At the end of the line is Thomas, who does without nothing for anybody, then Ben, then your father, then you, and then me. Nobody goes without to give me things.
You're making it sound as if I'm sat down and having a 3-course meal for my breakfast. I don't have anything. All I have put in my mouth today is 1.5 cheese sandwiches and that's it.
I've had apple peels and 2 slices of marmalade and bread.
I'm totally pissed.
Yeah, now it's my children.
Oh dear. I think there's some rather turbulent times ahead for us.
Every day, Ben has to work out how many units of gas, electricity and coal the family are using.
I think we need to... Is that all we need?
That's it?
Yes. I'm saying that. You have to cut down them.
He has to make sure they're keeping to their fuel target.
We've used 12 units this week and that's only from one day, which isn't very good, really.
And why do you give us to a bath at the same time?
Together, in
yeah.
the bath?
Yeah, that'll save water. And it'll save water and then you can head in. No, mum will be in there first.
Look at the colour of you. What makes you think that I want to get in your bath water? So we're only allowed to have 1 5-inch? Bath per night?
Yes. No, per week.
Well, if you're having 5 per week, you only have 25 inches used, don't you?
Why don't you check it on your own?
He just sticks to it so rigidly. There's no give and take with the child.
I don't think there's any point being a fuel warden if no one's going to take any notice of you. My granny's been painting things on the bathroom wall saying fuel warden stinks.
There is no joy, believe me, there is no joy sat in 2 inches of bath water which is covered in scum because you've no soap, you've no bubble bath, you've no shampoo when somebody comes in and turns the lights out on you.
We need to keep under our fuel target.
Ben? Do you mean what the light's doing on? Bloody midnight is still fuel warning.
We've just got into trouble because the fuel warden has got up for a wee. And we've just got into trouble because my bedroom light's been left on and we're not in there. So...
He's doing it in his sleep now. Fuel warning.
This is all we've got. She's going to probably make about, what, 4 cigarettes?
The shortages are now beginning to hit where they really hurt. With tobacco supplies fast running out, Lynn and Kirsty have been reduced to roll-ups.
I know it's something I should do. Stop smoking, that is. I just can't. And I can't at the moment without the modern patches, without the availability of food or something to nibble on. And no, I'm not going to nibble on a carrot because I hate carrots.
Well, let's be realistic. You know, when I was pregnant with Thomas, I didn't stop smoking. If that didn't tell me to stop smoking, then nothing, a war, nothing is going to tell me that I've got to stop smoking.
There is a simple solution to the cigarette shortage problem. Let women stop smoking. If they give up the habit, their health would be better, and tobacco would be available for those for whom nature intended it. Our fighting men.
The forces got an enormous number of cigarettes, even if you didn't want them. I mean, I was a non-smoker in the forces and got a free ration.
The media, of course, were blaming women for this shortage of cigarettes. Women had smoked before the Second World War, but during the war, the incident rose hugely. In fact, by the end of the war, nearly half the women in the country were smoking.
All smokers suffered, of course, but women suffered worse because in some instances, shopkeepers wouldn't serve them.
In that case, I think the time has come for us to cut off the cigarette supply.
I'm dreading the day Mrs. Hymers comes in and asks for cigarettes, and I have to say I'm sorry we haven't got any, because I know for a fact I'm going to lose my legs on that day. Or something severe will definitely happen.
Good morning, Mrs. Hymers. What can I do for you this morning? Mr. Hymers, all right?
He's very well, thank you.
And the children?
Very well, thank you, Mr. Lovegrove. I'd like... What have we got? Anything? Yeah?
Everything that you can see.
All right. Some cigarettes. What?
Unfortunately, no, we haven't got any cigarettes. At this moment in time, we can't get hold of any. I promise you, if I get any cigarettes in...
Where are you? No, I talked to loads of old people, and the shopkeeper always had, they could always get hold of me if it was only 10 cigarettes.
I know. Can I just serve my customer? I'll be 2 seconds.
On the counter.
Oh, cool. I'll grab that phone. Hang on.
Yeah, Crumbs.
Good morning, Crumbs. Speaking.
Right, well... Let's just see how far this war is going to go, because... Right, so the cigarettes are done?
Yes.
Yeah. Right, washing powder?
Washing powder.
I don't think powder stain
is... No washing powder at all.
Matches?
I'm trying, no matches.
Well, matches are no bloody good to us now, are they? Because we haven't got any cigarettes to light. Henna powder?
I've asked, but I haven't at the moment.
Grease glue paper?
I've asked, but I haven't at the moment.
Almond oil?
I've asked again, but I haven't got
olive
any.
Oil.
The same with the olive oil.
Corn flour.
I've asked, but I haven't got any as yet.
We are aware all the time of every single aspect of wartime economy. I have a tiny bit of cold cream left. I use it every other day, very sparingly. The toothpaste we keep in a little egg cup, which we let the children use because we know we can't get any more toothpaste. The adults use just water or salt and water, whichever they prefer. We don't use toothpaste at all. We don't have shampoo. We wash our hair in just water, and not as frequently as we would perhaps at home. The toilet roll. Now, at home, we'd normally have probably 5 toilet rolls a week. Here, we use 1 a week. And this is because we are constantly aware of the fact that paper is in short supply. The soap liquid that's left on and around the sink, I would use to wash my hands with. The washing powder's now gone, and it's hard water, so you never sort of get anything other than scum. I haven't seen a bubble since I left home. I don't want to be in the 1940s anymore. I want to go home.
ought to go home. I want to smoke cigarettes. I want to eat decent food and rest. That's what I want to do.
To add to the misery of having no cigarettes for the next few weeks, Kirsty has now dropped the lawnmower on her foot.
Let's try the cold compress to see if it fetches the bruising down.
With nearly half the nation's doctors and nurses on military duty, there was less medical assistance for those left at home.
And if you just keep your leg up for, say, 20 minutes. I don't think there's much else we can do, really.
But my big toe, I just can't feel my... You know when something feels really numb?
Kirsty's bruises, though painful, should soon heal.
Dropped, you know, as it went down.
I'm not saying I dropped it from a great height or whatever, but I dropped... It dropped, and then rolled.
We can't have them sitting around feeling sorry for themselves at a time when everyone was being urged to do their bit.
Well, what they could do, of course, is to do some voluntary work. I mean, over a million women joined the Women's Voluntary Service, the WVS. They escorted evacuees, they ran nurseries, they ran mobile canteens at bomb incidents. Don't forget, they really were in the front line during the Second World War. Nearly 250 members of the WVS were killed. Their motto was, if it needs doing, the WVS will do it.
Dear Mrs. Hymers, the Women's Voluntary Service was founded in 1938 to help with the war effort. Members of the local community will be in touch with you shortly to advise you of the jobs that we have chosen for you. I feel sick when I think about the work we're going to have to do in the voluntary services. These days, in the year 2000, you know exactly what you're going to do when you apply for a job. You know, to a certain extent, what the job entails. We have no conception whatsoever of what we're going to be asked to do in the voluntary services. And that makes me feel really apprehensive.
Our war cabinet have found Lynn and Kirsty voluntary jobs, similar to those that were carried out by the WVS.
Knock on the door, not there.
Hello.
Hello, my name's Siobhan Ross. I've come from St Mark's Nursery Group, and the Cabinet have given me your name as being interested in doing some voluntary work.
Oh, do you want to come through? To come
yes.
In? Okay.
If that's convenient. Come on in. I was just explaining to your daughter, I've come from St Mark's Nursery Group.
Right.
Your name has been given to me by the Cabinet. They've said that you were interested in voluntary work. Can I interest you in coming to work at the nursery group? With either of you, I'd welcome any help whatsoever.
I'm quite happy to do that, but obviously I cannot give you a definite decision now at this present time about tomorrow.
Right.
Because I don't know how I'm going to feel in the morning.
No, that's all right.
But I am quite happy
to do
that.
You're quite happy. Yeah. They're all fairly clean children. We haven't got any head lice at the moment. So,
Hello. Hello. I'm from. Been asked to call on you by the Cabinet Office to discuss some voluntary work.
I'm your woman. Come in. Walk this way.
While the wartime WVS collected for families who'd been bombed out, Lynn and Kirsty will collect for the local charity shop.
Mm. How do you think you could collect the sacks? Have you got anything?
Oh, my daughter's got a little truck for her bike, which you can't pull. So, don't know how that one will go, but I shall work around that one.
Mm-hmm.
We'll just do what we can for you.
Excellent.
That's all I can say at this moment in time.
Excellent.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Who's going to go to Lovegroves? Who's going to take the kids to school? Who's going to do the washing? Who's going to do the 101 things that need doing in a 1940s house?
Accentuate the positive in them.
eliminate the negative. Latch on to the affirmative. Don't mess with Mr. In Between.
Part of me wants to go home. Part of me wants to stay and do better. Because I feel that there's been some failure here. I've got to get into a more positive frame of mind, and at the moment I'm struggling with that.
I think I'll frighten children. A bit stern, a bit strict.
Over 1,400 state nurseries were set up to free women for war work. A mother could leave her child before breakfast and collect it after supper, knowing that it would have balanced meals as well as free milk, juice and rosehip syrup. Women were encouraged to have more children, and pregnant mothers were given extra rations. The birth rate went up by 22%. Some doctors even advised having babies as a cure for wartime anxiety.
You've got to accentuate the positive, eliminate the negative.
I'm resisting it.
Put any knickers for me later.
Outside the house, Lynn and Kirsty are exposed to the temptations of modern living.
Yeah. And a cup of tea or coffee for you?
In wartime, this cake would have used all their points rations for at least 2 months.
Yeah.
What's more, it was illegal for bakers to use icing.
It's that sort of coffee as well, you know. Don't mention the name.
Yeah.
My relationship with Kirsty has changed a great deal over the last week. Kirsty and I have always argued. Normally I'm the stronger one, but the last week has sort of turned that on its head. Kirsty has become even stronger than she was before and has almost in a sense looked after me.
The turning point for me was when we had such a bad couple of days. We didn't have the cigarettes and one thing or another, we both got very down. For the first time ever, my dad was not around for my mum. I felt like it was my place that I had to do something for my mum and for myself. And I felt as though I had to be the stronger person. And I just felt like we would just go around in circles if somebody doesn't pull themselves together and sort things out.
Then we don't need to feel like complete failures, do we?
We must all stick together and the clouds will soon roll by. We must.
I think collecting the scope bags is a worthwhile experience because at the end of the day it is benefiting somebody else. I don't mind the hard physical work because women in the 40s would have done physical hard work.
The poorest of us all, we must all.
During the war, 241 members died while on active duty. So whatever we are asked to do, we know that we have to do it because we'd be letting the WVS down.
Up in the morning early, the physical exercises for ladies.
To your looks. Beauty is definitely a duty. When you look your best, you feel self-confident, and your confidence transmits itself to those around you.
While beauty for duty became a popular wartime slogan, the challenge for women was to be beautiful without cosmetics.
I personally think 1940s women would hang on to the makeup to the bitter end. Lipstick was supposed to be worn every day. It was called the Red Badge of Courage and worn throughout the war.
From 1941 onwards, it became virtually illegal to manufacture hair and beauty products. This only encouraged women to turn to the black market. Even legitimate shops sold nail varnish disguised as ladder stop. In all aspects of beauty and feminine hygiene, the wartime woman was forced to improvise.
I have become desperate in the last few days because my white roots are showing through on my hair and I thought a vegetable dye would be the best way forward, so I'm finding all the things from the garden that I know create some sort of stain and really making it up as I go along.
It stinks.
How's it looking?
Dark.
Yeah? Or are you just saying that to make me happy?
No, it's...
hope when you go out it doesn't rain.
Oh, Kirsty! It's all over me!
When I put on that uniform, I change. I become Mrs. Organised. Mrs. Wonderful. Mrs. Can cope with anything. Mrs. Will cope with anything. We'll push boundaries further.
Are you fond of this hat?
The uniform is doing for me what Prozac does for thousands of women in the year 2000.
Hey, good looking. Say what's cooking.
Morale is up, and Lynn and Kirsty have decided they could be doing more for their war effort. Now they've taken matters into their own hands. They're giving up their nursery school duties and have chosen instead to go and work in a local retirement home.
I thought working with older people would actually be better for me because it would enable me to give something back to the wartime generation that did suffer so much. And I think they'll enjoy perhaps the uniform and to chat about what we're doing. And I will feel more useful and more really in keeping with what a WVS lady would have tried to do throughout the war.
Just a little bit of grape on me.
Yes, a little bit. That's lovely.
Okay. Lovely to see your uniform again.
Oh, thank you. Yes. Is it right? Does it look?
Oh, I don't know. Yes, it looks lovely.
Does it look right?
Yes.
You'll do.
Shortages are hurting. You know, there's no soap, shampoo.
That's why her hair's like this.
What did you use? I'm just water.
Oh no, just soap.
Oh, Lux Flakes. Mm. Yeah.
Did you ever use Lux Flakes? No, we weren't
favourite. Yeah, Lux Flakes on your
hair. We weren't that well off. It was soap.
I hope you're only having 5 inches of water in your bath.
Certainly are. We've got a black line round.
Was that the tide mark?
Yeah, we've got black lines round the black line because there's nothing to clean the bath with.
When the older generation says to the younger generation that we're better off than they were, then I really do believe that. You know, having listened to some of the experiences and having to do some of the physical hard work that I've had to do, I have got a lot of admiration for the people that lived through the war.
When I'd cleared the plates from the dining tables, the food I was putting into the waste bin would have fed my family for a few days. At home in 2000, I'm the most wasteful woman in the world, but here, I can't bear to waste anything.
It was actually illegal to waste things, and you were not supposed to throw away paper. Paper had to be reused, and it said that at the bottom of every magazine. You were not supposed to feed your pets anything that was possible for human consumption. And indeed, a Miss Bridget O'Sullivan in Barnet in Hertfordshire in 1942, she was fined £10 with 2 guineas costs for feeding bread to the birds.
As you can see, the national loaf is its usual fresh and spongy self, not.
Their loaf is bread made from national wheatmeal flour, which had calcium and vitamins added.
It is horrible, it is dry and it's got really, really hard crusts. And it's very grey. I also find it really difficult to keep it fresh.
The national loaf was so unpopular in its day, it became known as Hitler's secret weapon. And the government was believed to have put out the rumour that it had aphrodisiac properties to encourage the nation to eat more.
Hang on. It's not right. The bread's not right. It's not just stale, it smells Faustian.
I know it's not bad, but I'm hungry. So.
Mr. Lovegrove, my grocer, thinks that the worst thing in the world that can happen to him is me going in his shop and him not being able to supply cigarettes. But I have to tell you, he's wrong. Because what he hasn't yet seen is me expecting important visitors and having no vim.
Marguerite Patton wrote to my mum and said she'd like to come for tea. As I sort of adapted the role of being the baker, I've got to somehow make some nice cakes and nice things for her to eat, which is beginning to stress me out a little bit because I'm not quite sure what to make.
Kirsty has every reason to be anxious, as Marguerite Patton was the most famous cook of her day. She taught a nation how to make do with cunning recipes for mock apricot tarts and honey made from boiled parsley.
It's a nightmare. I've been awake all night. I'm really nervous. I've come out in a nervous rash. So, I mean, I am enjoying doing it, but I just, it's the thought of, you know, Marguerite Patton eating my food. And it'll probably all turn out wrong and I'll probably burn it all. But if I burn it, I'll have to put that on a plate because I won't have anything else.
Under normal circumstances, I would clean this house and polish it from top to bottom if I was having such an important visitor as Marguerite. But because of the wall work I'm doing, the priorities change, everything changes.
I'm making a chocolate cake and I'm using the children's eggs, which are normally saved to keep them to make eggy bread. I feel incredibly guilty, but there you go.
Lynn's first priority is now her voluntary work. So, Kirsty's left to do all the catering on her own. Kirsty's struggling to make do with what's available, but the sausage meat doesn't look promising.
The sausage meat boiling in a pan look absolutely disgusting, and I really don't want to have to serve that to anybody.
At the nursing home Lynn now visits daily, she has made friends with wartime fireman Reginald Long. Reg was keen for her to know of some of the unsung heroes of the home front.
I was on leave. It was my wedding anniversary. Mm. And they were killed on a Sunday night, you see. Of course, I go back Monday morning and the wife had made a lovely cake for the boys at the station. And when I got to the gate, I knew there was something wrong, you see. And I said to Reggie Neil, what's gone wrong? He said, something very serious. And I knew then. So, of course, the cake went home again.
And what had happened to your friends?
Well, they were at an assembly point, and you had to go to an assembly point, and then they dispatched the crews from that assembly point to wherever you were required. Well, this crew, there was about three crews there, and they got a direct hit, you see, before they were dispersed.
And how many were killed, Reg?
21.
21
in one night, 21 Beckenham boys in one night.
What on earth have we got to complain about because we can't get milk or shampoo or soap or washing powder or cigarettes even? What does it matter? We don't have death. We don't have fear for our lives. So the least we can do is fulfil the other bits of it. We owe it to the people who did suffer and did struggle to do the best we can.
We've beaten our fuel target by 13 units, which is pretty good. And we beat it by 2 units, and that's like 15 units that we've saved. So that is quite a big achievement for me, really. And I'm pretty happy with it this week.
She's here!
When they first arrived 7 weeks ago, it was Marguerite Patton who introduced the family to the 1940s house.
Well, I'm very much looking forward to seeing the family again. I liked them so much when I met them briefly, and I'm longing to hear how they're getting on, how they've met the challenge.
Hello, Lynn. How lovely to see you again.
Oh, honey.
And tomatoes.
You must be ready for a cup of tea after all your hard work.
Lovely. I say, haven't you been busy? Well, what a splendid spread.
I've made a dark chocolate cake. And a sultana orange cake and some jam tarts.
Oh, well.
And I've never...
You people said you didn't make cakes.
Well, no, I have never, ever made a cake till I came to this house. In fact, I've never made as much as this in my entire life.
Well, isn't your mother clever?
Very.
And do tell me about these. They look absolutely fascinating.
Well, those are sausage, meat and apple. But it was actually for sandwich filling, to make sandwiches. But I decided to make tarts with them.
I congratulate you. I've raised my cup of tea in tribute to the both. You've done jolly well.
The war years were times of problems. But I think it gave many of us a chance to discover depths which we didn't know we had, talents we didn't know we had before. And I think both Kirsty and Lynn typifies how women coped. Kirsty's, who'd never baked much before, now has discovered this talent for baking. And Lynn has done sterling work, going to nursing homes and talking to old people. They have typified the way women coped during those war years. Pretty good sets we were. We managed beautifully.
Someday, when I'm awfully low, when the world is cold, I will feel a glow just thinking of you.
I have to say, this is an interesting sort of journey for me, and perhaps for all of us. I'm finding my own strengths, I'm finding my own weaknesses, and it's changing me.
Yeah, we've had a lot of physical hard work and mental hard work, but at least we can say at the end of it that we did it.
There is nothing for
I felt proud of my daughter for the way she coped with everything and the way she handled everything. Very proud, and that's a nice feeling for me as a mother, and I must remember to tell her. Into this 1940s project that it would have such a great impact on our lives.
It's time to find the Anderson.
It's just made me look at things in a totally different light. It was 9 weeks living on the edge, really.
Six months after their mock war, the Hymers are back at home in the West Yorkshire town of Otley. We've come to find out what went on behind the scenes and see how the experience has affected their lives.
Michael,
yes?
Can you come and help with this bed?
No, I'm not doing beds.
I think we ought to change it into sheets and blankets.
I think it's silly.
Well, we're not sleeping very well, are we?
Coming back home was quite a shock. For me, it was like walking into another world. And it just all seemed so stark and so harsh.
Kirsty and her boys are now back living in their home at the opposite end of town. Thomas and Ben have returned to their normal school routine.
When I returned home, I just wanted to go wild, do what I wanted, spend what I wanted, put in my mouth whatever I wanted, and think of myself and not other people. And that's what I did.
This website puts you in touch with an amazing experience in living history.
It was strange coming back, just doing normal 2000 things, because I'd been isolated from all these pleasures.
Oh, it's me!
It's sweet.
I thought it was good coming back, but I still miss the 1940s house in loads of ways.
I didn't really miss the PlayStation or the TV.
I was just enjoying myself so much. I just thought about all the 1940s stuff.
It was very important to all of us that we did this experience to the best of our ability without cheating or feeling though we'd let the older generation down.
So did the Heimers live up to their own high standards? Or did they cheat? The evidence of our cameras shows they didn't always play by the rules. Hair creams were rarely available in wartime.
I need to confess. Whilst I was on my last business trip home, the gentleman gave me this, as you can see. I haven't yet opened it, the seal's still intact. So I'm toying with my conscience at the moment. I was going to just decant some of it into there and say nothing, but that's not playing by the rules, so...
I never opened the bigger one that I brought.
But I did.
My hair gets progressively more folds.
And mine gets more and more black.
Well, it made me look right, Charlie, because I've shown that to the camera sealed, and as far as I was concerned, it left the house sealed.
Well, what I did was, I opened it up a little bit, took a bit out, put it on my hair, and then sealed it back up again.
Well, can you not see that people think that's me, not you? And here's me, like a prized chump, said, and it's going to stay sealed.
I've done two things. The first thing was...
Did it involve a soldier?
No. The first thing was for the benefit of the children. Do you remember when we were invited to the Beetle Drive?
Have you built the air raid shelter yet?
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, we used to play this down the air raid shelter.
The local people of West Wickham invited our family to a Beetle Drive.
What you've got on the two?
It was the first week that the rations had kicked in, and I'd had the kids come in to me crying and telling me they were hungry. There were some rather nice buns there. And I put them in my gas mask box.
Did you? Do you know what?
How many? Oh,
so did I! I wondered why there was more buns than I thought.
Cakes from the whisk drive.
Was your other one then, Mum?
You know when you was made fuel...
Warden?
Yes, fuel yes. Warden. We're only allowed 3 shovelfuls of coal.
Yes.
Well, one day I only used 3, but it wasn't enough to keep the burner going in the kitchen. I needed to burn something, so I had to go get some more coal.
Was that the time when I caught you hanging out of the window?
No, I did it several times.
What?
I needed the boiler. I couldn't let that boiler go out because I had to burn my sanitary towels on the boiler, which would have been very difficult for me to explain to Ben, so I just waited till he'd gone to bed and would pile more fuel on the boiler.
Let me go underneath, Kirsty.
I hated the idea of having to burn them on a fire, but more than that, I hated the idea of having to keep them in a brown paper bag under my bed.
Okay.
What's a sanitary towel?
Might be the next question.
Shall we leave, chaps?
Without the children's cooperation, I don't think we could have done this.
Please.
Don't do ties.
The children themselves elected to wear 1940s school uniform, even though it was stiff and itchy and scratchy. They did it. They elected to have 1940s packed lunch, as opposed to a school dinner. They could have had a school dinner, but they themselves chose not to. They did do without an awful lot of things.
I'm sure all I'm going to do. This fruit pasta. Normally my favourite kind, the red kind. What should I do? What would you do? Eh? Would you? Sure. Okay. I'm a greater. Or am I? I could do. But you never know.
I ate half. And then I ate the other half.
I really do think that although we did have, yes, we did sin a little, my overall feeling is that none of us did really too badly. We could have done worse. I'm sure we could have done worse.
Yummy, yummy, scrummy. I accosted a perfect stranger on the street, dressed in my tarty dress, my open pinny,
my WVS hat and said, "Hey, have you got any cigarettes?"
How low is that? Can't believe I did this. I'm sure that film's lying.
Lynn's artfulness in attempting to beat wartime cigarette shortages knew no bounds. She even tried renting out the family shelter for 20 senior service a night.
That's my Anderson shelter that you're letting out there.
Two desperate times.
It's the Buy for Victory campaign. Here she is, with all the little flags. Buy for Victory. We need a tin, the milk tin. Put paper on it, Buy for Victory. Sell the flags. But there's only us in the war.
With no takers for the shelter, Lynn came up with a new plan. To sell wartime memorabilia.
Nobody's going to give you money for those, then. They're modern people. For a little piece of nostalgia. I would.
I can't believe that I've gone out into the street in that uniform to obtain modern money under false pretences to buy modern cigarettes. What have I become? A criminal? The war made me a criminal. Or it feels as if it did. What else did I do?
I know that efforts are being made to get hold of some Turkish cigarettes.
Right, can you see if you can get some good hashish, please, then? We'll mix it with that. You must know a man
on the black market.
And then we'll mix it with that, and we'll be happy all day long.
Well, it'll put you in a good humour.
Yeah, 4 ounces of Moroccan black, please, if you'd like to put that on the list of wants.
You're joking, aren't you?
No.
Throughout their wartime experience, the Heimers were under the supervision of our war cabinet. What did they have to say about Lynn's transgressions?
The crime rate actually tripled during the war. Blackout gave an opportunity for looting, there was truancy from schools with their supervision, though I doubt if there was a huge market for hashish.
To be fair, I'd read in one of the 1940s medical books that women did get this for period pains and for depression, and for headaches. And I had the depression and Kirsty had the period pains, so, and the headaches. So we did feel we should have had some of that.
Oh, there's parcel, Kirsty!
Parcel?
From the war cabinet. Oh, it's not something live, is it? Kirsty? It's very light. Something live. That's an empty box.
I bet we have to fill it.
With what?
Stuff for troops.
Troops? I mean, I've just had dry bread and marmalade for my lunch.
I bet that's what it's for. I might be wrong. Why else would you get an empty box, though?
Throughout the war, the cabinet for me was a constant source of irritation. I despised them. I dreaded their letters falling on the doormat. It was always bad news. It was always more rules and regulations.
1940s House War Cabinet. We have now progressed your experience to the next phase. With immediate effects, we are moving events forward to the mid-war year of 1942. Well, 3 years and war will be over, won't it? We have therefore provided a box and would ask you to give up the following articles. Cleaning materials, no. No, no, no. Well, I might as well just give them the bloody house.
So how do we feel the family did during this experiment?
The family could have done better, I think, in some areas. There were occasions when they could have improvised, found substitutes when there were shortages and rationing. Lynn, after all, was obsessed about keeping the house clean. She hoarded vim when perhaps she could have used paraffin, ammonia, vinegar, that sort of thing for cleaning.
Oh, I suppose I'm supposed to take the clothes outside and beat them against a rock, am I?
During the war, gardening, growing your own food, was tremendously important. It was a really valuable extra source of food for the family. And I think our family could have done a bit more.
I couldn't have done any more. and I don't think you could. And I did feel that that's one of the jobs my husband should have taken on board when he was at home at the weekend. So over to you, dear.
I freely admit that I didn't do everything I should have done in the garden.
I was a little disappointed in the way the family went about erecting the Anderson shelter. They seemed to me to do the absolute minimum. They might, for instance, have put a much thicker layer of earth on the top of the shelter, and even more important, perhaps, they might have tried erecting a wall of sandbags to protect the entrance.
The construction of the Anderson shelter, I thought I carried out to the book.
The house is supposed to protect the entrance from blast.
The reason I didn't sandbag the front of the Anderson was that in the book it said if it was positioned within 18 feet of the house itself would protect the entrance from blast. So that's why I didn't pile up the front with sandbags. However, if that's the case, I'm quite prepared if they give me another Anderson shelter. I'll have another go and they can help me dig the hole and pile the earth on.
Now, another area where the Heimers family have not lived up to the wartime generation is in salvage.
Salvage? There was nothing wasted, was there?
Your waste paper is urgently needed to replace imported material.
You want the paper?
Well, no, it doesn't matter. You need to keep it, though.
And do what with it?
There's a thing on the milk about saving waste paper.
Well, what are we going to do with this? Hang it out to dry?
They're saying we didn't have any salvage. We salvaged everything we had. They say Granny should have improvised. What with? What do you expect us to do? We're a 2000 family, not a 1940s family.
The family are very critical of us as a war cabinet, but in fact our role was essentially to replicate the authentic conditions of the war.
They were a faceless, nameless bunch of bureaucrats and I didn't want anything to do with them.
There may be difficult days ahead of us, far more difficult than we've seen yet. We shall still need feeding.
Sod it! It's the whole of the tea. The crumble. All the peaches. Oh, the tarts are going to get it as well.
During our wartime experience, we did have a lot of laughs.
Oh, you're joking!
Oh, you've got to be
kidding.
No, 2 minutes. 2 minutes.
Get other things. Oh. Right. Get in there, no. Get in the air shelter. Pull fasten this bloody
thing. As a family, we do laugh a lot and we do have jokes. And you know, if things get bad then sometimes we just laugh.
Get the potty, I'm gonna wet myself.
When I saw the programmes, I was slightly concerned that there was too much humour and it might be perceived that we were just larking about.
Did you rig this picture?
Oh, yeah.
Having thought about it since, I've talked to quite a lot of people as well. There were light-hearted moments, even in adversity or danger. There is humour and laughter, and that helps you through it.
Have to bloody stay there.
I can't spend the rest of the war like this. What?
It's that man again.
Would you like some tripe?
Yes, I'd like some tripe.
Right, George, switch on the wireless, will you?
Very good, circumference. All right, circumference. Certainly, circumference. Goodbye, circumference. That was Winston Churchill.
What's MP mean, Mr. Tom?
Mostly promises.
I think a lot of the Itmar humour was popular because in a way it poked fun at authority and people were very aware that they were being told virtually everything they had to do during the war, and I think it was a common thing that everybody could identify with.
Anybody found kicking the gong around? We're going to clout in the kisser with the kipper.
Yes, we had the laughter, of course we had the laughter, and having seen the film it reminds me how much laughter we did have. But there were some very hard times in between.
Life is fair, gloom and misery everywhere, stormy weather.
When I was in the war, I never thought about my aches and pains. I'd just get up and think, oh, my back hurts. And then I'd just get on with the day and forget all about it.
We were working to the bone. We were working so hard, we were working our socks off.
These days I just throw the washing in the washing machine. But as a wartime housewife, I used to get up at 6 o'clock and it would often be midnight before the last sheet was on the bed.
I don't know how she managed to get through it without having a heart attack or something. But she did it, and I'm proud of her for doing it and coping with everything.
We wanted to find out how 9 weeks of wartime living would affect the health of the Heimers family. Before they began, the adults underwent a series of rigorous tests. These were repeated when the Heimers war was over.
The results showed that all the adults in the house had lost weight, and our more detailed tests revealed this was all body fat. In fact, they preserved their muscle tissue. They were physically fitter. This was confirmed when we saw that their blood pressure and their resting heart rate had come down too, suggesting that they were much healthier at the end of the study than when they first went into the house.
Why was everything about me physically better when I was on this totally mundane and uninteresting diet, which I didn't feel was giving me the right nutrients?
The health and well-being of many people did improve during the war, in spite of the shortages.
Yes, and what we often forget is that before the war, only half the population had enough income to get themselves a healthy diet, whereas when the war occurred, unemployment disappeared, there was lots of overtime.
Men in industry often worked away from home, so Michael came back to work in Otley as part of his wartime experience. He's head of production at an engineering factory that makes parts for aircraft, a job he might well have done in the war.
During the war, there was a large Avro factory just above Otley where they built Lancasters, amongst other things. And Lynn's father actually worked at that factory on the Avro Lancasters, and that's how he came to Otley.
When he was back in Otley on war work, the Heimers' neighbour, Sarah Drake, cooked all Michael's meals, based on authentic recipes of the day.
I used to be Michael's British restaurant. And he came home at 7 o'clock and he had things like sausage meatloaf, stew, dumplings, stuffed cabbage.
During the war, British restaurants, as they were called, sprung up all over the country. They offered nourishing three-course meals for 11 pence, £1.50 in today's money. No question of Michael going hungry.
Ironically, although the Heimers found their diet unappetizing and boring, they were getting all the nutrients they needed. They had much less fat and they were cooking proper meals rather than relying heavily on snacks and processed foods.
So we can reassure those viewers who kindly sent in food parcels, the Heimers family was definitely not starving.
The fact that some food parcels were sent to the family because viewers felt they really were starving is wonderful. And it is typical of what happened during the real war years. Whether you were rich or poor, you were facing the same common danger. And we all cared about each other, how we were faring, were we ill, were we well.
There was a time when I just thought, I can't do this. I cannot do this anymore. Physically, I was exhausted. Mentally, I was all over the place. And I felt so lonely, so terribly, terribly isolated.
It is so hot. The washing and the ironing on a day like today, I don't know how they did it. I am absolutely wringing wet. It's 7 o'clock. Just come out the air raid shelter we've been in since 12 o'clock last night. Tired, cold, ick all over.
I felt sorry for them because they were looking so very tired. And Peter decided that they needed some firewood, so made a bundle of sticks and did it as it would have been, with the wire wrapped around it. And we took it down and they seemed to accept it very gratefully.
Mr. and Mrs. Tilling knocked on the door and Mrs. Tilling said, "I know how hard it is for you and we're going to be your wartime neighbours." And they came in, had a cup of tea and told us about their real wartime experiences. Nothing to do with our pretend war, but real wartime experiences.
She just needed a bit of comfort and to have her confidence boosted a bit, that she was doing well, that she was doing a very good job in the circumstances.
She gave me a big hug. That was the best hug anybody's ever given me, because the hug was what I needed, more than anything else in the world, more than sticks, more than food, more than cigarettes. I needed that hug from Mrs. Tilling. And it just turned the whole thing round, and I never felt like throwing in the towel again.
That's Peter. I'm down on there.
You stood there sort of very nonchalant, aren't you? Sort of hand in the pocket.
Yeah, I see, yeah.
You can tell it's you.
Yeah, we said that. Yeah.
Peter Tilling moved to Braemar Gardens in 1932. He was just 13 when the first bomb dropped on the street.
It was only about a 150-pound bomb, but it did a lot of damage because it was between the two houses.
So it actually landed behind...
It landed on the side wall of this house.
Right.
Only 7 miles from Braemar Gardens, Chislehurst Caves was a refuge for families sheltering from Hitler's bombs. Night after night, in the darkest hours of the war, 22 miles of disused limestone mines became home to 15,000 people.
I found Chislehurst Caves very interesting because I thought out of the whole experience it was the one thing that brought me the closest to how people in the 1940s really lived and how they felt.
Well, so you could get them in the right position to operate.
Chislehurst Caves tells a story of how the wartime generation pulled together. Here, a thriving community built its own hospital, concert hall, hairdressers, canteen, church, and even a cinema.
The long tunnels of the caves were used to just house bunks which were two or three tiers high, I believe.
Like mine, aren't they?
How did they keep the children occupied all night? How did they keep them quiet when there were several thousand people coming and going? How did they manage to get their sleep? How did they stop the children from being frightened?
Well, when I went in that and I saw all that, I thought to myself I wouldn't have wanted to be living in the war.
It really did show the hardships of the 1940s housewife protecting her family. And I find that to be one of the greatest stories of the home front. So why don't we know about it? There's this strange divide between the reality of war, the reality of war on the home front, and our perception of it as told by our parents. I don't think the true horrors of war have really been passed on to my generation. Not the war on the home front.
The more the experience affected Lynn, the more she became concerned that those who suffered on the home front got little help after the war. She discussed this with a friend she visited every day at the local nursing home, wartime fireman Reg Long.
My house was bombed and
was
my
it?
Wife and baby were trapped under the stairs. Yeah.
I didn't know that. Mm,
they got them out all right. The house was in a bit of a mess.
So you must have been frightened when you opened the front door or when you got saw
well,
in your
house.
Well,
not any front door.
No, sir.
to open.
Nowadays, counselling's available. Reg himself thinks this is one of the good things about the later part of the 20th century, that people can get the help that they need if they're witnesses to horrendous events, but in those days they couldn't. Yes, I mean, there must have been some grim times for you at that.
We had some very grim times, some that I wouldn't even repeat to you.
In one of my conversations with Reg, I learnt that not everybody could cope. There were quite a few suicides. That's something that never occurred to me.
Many people who suffered great tragedies and awful experiences during the war had a period where they didn't want to talk about it. They just wanted to forget it, keep it to themselves. And then as the years went on, they were ready to talk about it again. They were ready for people to listen, and then there was nobody really around who wanted to listen.
Back at home in Otley, Lynn continues to make friends with and talk to people of the wartime generation.
My new friend, Olive, has been helping me rediscover things about my own past and how the war affected people in my own town.
Well, that's my father, before he lost his hair.
Oh, yes, of course it is. Yes, yeah. I can see, yes.
Look at my mother, she's always immaculately dressed.
She perhaps knew some of the American
soldiers. No, perhaps about it. I don't feel that my generation, late 50s, 60s, we didn't want to know about the war. It wasn't anything to do with us. We were the new generation of teenagers, of young people. Later generations of parents are better at relationships with their children. They're able to talk more freely and openly. They have more in common. My generation couldn't have anything in common with a generation that had been through a world war.
There may be trouble ahead, but while there's moonlight and music and love and romance, let's face the music and dance.
As a family, I do think from coming back from the 1940s experience, we have all changed. I think myself and the children have got more confidence.
I am a single mum and my husband left me, and that affected me for, you know, quite a while. It's still something in me that I do lack in confidence.
Yay!
Kirsty, she has changed. She's become far, far more independent. She's her own woman. She's her own family unit. She seems to be coping with anything life throws at her at the moment. It's been very good for Kirsty.
I think the 1940s experience was good for the boys because the minds were more stimulated there. There was no television or PlayStation games.
At the Earth's Ben.
I think Ben and Thomas could still live without the television and the PlayStation.
On PlayStation games, you seemed to get bored with them because you hadn't rearranged them because they're on a computer. If you make your own games, you can rearrange it so you don't get bored.
Right, should we close the hatch so we've got more room?
1940s house, they hardly ever argued and they did play together.
We argued less in the 1940s. We don't know why, I just think it was probably because there was less to argue over. Because normal things we argue over is who gets to go on the PlayStation, who, silly stuff like Tom taking my things, because we didn't have any. Tom couldn't take anything.
But also
we didn't have a PlayStation to argue over.
We shared them all, so there's nothing to take, really. It was half as yours and half as mine.
Yeah.
Itmar has today joined the army, and from a garrison theatre somewhere in England we say once more, it's that man again.
With no television in their wartime home, Ben and Thomas produced their own version of a famous wartime entertainment. As it was a special occasion, Thomas was allowed to borrow a modern torch to create his lighting effects.
Hello, and welcome to IPA! It's that Ben again!
After you, Sizzle. I insist, Sizzle. No, I insist, Rob. Anyway.
Thomas, I feel, is the one that's gained the most from doing the 1940s. He's always felt that he was in the shadow of his brother, and because of his speech problems as well. He's picked up a merit badge at school, which they only give out to one child out the whole of the year. I think he's the only child in the class that asks for homework.
Anyway, yes. I'm sorry, Rob, if I hit you with the sizzle. Rob, I'm sorry, sizzle, if I hit you with the chisel.
Ben, when he comes in from school, I don't have to constantly be at him to do his homework. He'll come in and do it straight away. And that has only happened since we came back from doing the 1940s experience.
Have you ever wondered what a puppet looked like naked? There it is!
Puppet.
Oh, it's that sad time of night.
Aww. And
the end of the show.
Aww.
The children in general have become less demanding, I would think, in everything, in sort of, you know, buying things and wanting things. They appreciate the things that they've got now rather than constantly wanting more things all the time.
Five, six.
Since they've been back, Michael and the boys have maintained their wartime habit of creating their own amusements out of nothing.
Dude's Bug Alley is a board game that we invented after the 1940s, and it's basically just the Spitfires trying to protect London and the Doodlebugs trying to get through to get to London. We did a map of West Wickham because they had to fly over West Wickham to get to London.
The point.
It's sort of like Drafts, but with a different background.
Oh, yes, just in time.
While I was in the 1940s house, I'd rediscovered the joy of writing, and as I wrote more and more letters and wrote a diary, I found that words and phrases were coming back to me, whereas prior to that, and I couldn't string a sentence together some days, which I believed to be either advancing years or the menopause, but the reality was I wasn't using language to its full extent. I think letters are almost a form of a therapy, because as you're writing, you're actually thinking about what you're saying, you're thinking about what you feel, whereas on a phone call it's easy to just glibly say, yeah, I'm fine, yeah, things great. There's more truth somehow in a letter than in a telephone call.
Before the 1940s, my mum would go out, you could go have a drink with her, a few bottles of beer, she'd spend loads of money on clothes, food, anything. Now, she's totally different.
Lynn doesn't drive the car anymore, and I am very surprised she doesn't, because it took her years and thousands upon thousands of pounds to pass, and now she doesn't drive the car anywhere. She used to go to the supermarket an awful lot. In fact, she was forever at the Rotten Place, but isn't anymore. She takes her basket, that silly basket, down to town every single day, shopping at the greengrocers, the bakery, the butchers.
The biggest impact that the wartime experience has had on my current day living is that it's saving me so much money.
Good morning.
Come on, can I help you?
Can I have £2 of mince, please?
Absolutely, pleasure.
I save money on the
petrol. I saved money by buying fresh produce instead of pre-packaged. I buy all my food fresh daily from local shops, not supermarkets. One of the things that was very important to me throughout the wartime experience was my grocer, Mr. Lovegrove. He was a port in a storm. If my circumstances were different and I was perhaps on my own or elderly, then it would almost be a lifeline, the local shopkeeper. And I do feel very strongly that I must champion the cause of the local shopkeeper, not only from a social point of view, but because I found it to be cheaper.
A comparison of Lynn's weekly shopping expenses before and after her 1940s experience shows a dramatic change.
Today, for the first time, I've actually sat down and compared my pre-war budget, my wartime budget, and my post-war budget. And I have to say, I'm absolutely shocked. I've looked through my bank statements from before the war, which have all my shopping bills on. There's not one week where I spend less than £200 on food. Moving on, because I am still shocked, I decided to look at my current bank statements, and here it's much more hopeful for my future and for Michael's. I'm spending no more than £100 a week. Most weeks it's £70 or £80 on the food bill. So that I've reduced the food bills by more than 50%.
How do these vegetables, Kirsty, if you make the pudding?
You didn't say I had to come make a pudding.
No, but as you're here for Sunday lunch and you're so good at puddings, I thought today you could make the pudding.
I miss the humble that Mum used to make and the food and the meals that Annie used to make because, well, Annie still makes the meals, 1940s meals, but Mum doesn't normally make puddings anymore for us.
I haven't seen we've got any fish to make pudding with.
Must say your fridge is looking empty.
I defy you to find anything you can throw out.
Every nook and cranny of this house is filled with possessions. Things that we don't need, things that aren't useful, things that really scream excess, excess, excess. And to me, that's what modern life now is. It's excesses, too many.
We now on a Sunday have a proper traditional Sunday dinner with all the family there. We were used to, you know, being overfaced with food. Now we just, you know, get what we're given, and that's enough. I think we've learnt to accept that we just, you know, what's on our plate, and that's it.
It's from the butcher.
The rest of the family signed up for the 1940s experience as they wanted to cure Michael of his rose-tinted view of the period.
Right.
Meat.
But things have not worked out quite as expected.
When Dad was in the house, straight away it was in the role of a 1940s man.
Mm-hmm. Straight away?
Straight away. Yeah. At the table, wanting his food on the table. And if the wife wasn't running around after him, then the daughter had to do. Mm.
Oh, well, that's bloody knocked me again, then.
He's still the 1940s husband. He expects his meals on the table. He expects home cooking. It never bothered him before.
And it's not only that, it's a legacy you're passing on to your grandson.
No.
Yeah. Who very much seems to be taking that attitude as well.
No. Dad has not changed. It's you that's changed. You want to now become from being a modern woman working woman to being do anything for your husband, make his meals woman, like you did in the 1940s house. Since you've come home, it's you that has changed and he's got exactly what he wants.
Thank you.
beguiled again, a simpering, whimpering child again, bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I. Couldn't sleep and wouldn't sleep. Then love came and told me I shouldn't sleep. Bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I.
I'm still just as keen on the 1940s as I was before we started the programme. The only difference is now I've got somebody to share my enthusiasm, because Lynn has become as interested, in fact far more interested and absorbed in the 40s.
This is the first photo ever taken of Michael and I as a couple when I was age 16. And look what I'm wearing. 1940s clothes. I think we've come full circle. No wonder he's a happy man.
Bewitched, bothered, and bewildered am I.
Before the 1940s, she didn't behave like a normal Anna. She behaved like a... She was cool. She was a little dude. And it's weird because we were used to the granny that's cool and trendy and goes around drinking Budweiser and everything. But now she's gone into this old nanny mode.
It's not fastened at the bottom.
For all their new domestic economies, Lynn and Michael have had one major extravagance. They've acquired a garage down the road, like the one they had in the 1940s house. And this one has a car in it.
It's a 1949 Ford Prefect that we saw advertised locally, and I think both realised as soon as we saw it that we had to have it. It just seemed to be the perfect vehicle for us.
I was looking forward to Grandpa getting this really new snazzy car, convertible, big Mercedes Benz. But no, Grandpa goes and buys his old chug-along, which you have to wind up to go anyway.
Peter the Prefect represents for me the happy and joyous parts of the 1940s experience, the picnics and the good times we had as a family.
Never thought my heart could be so yearning. Why did I decide to roam? Gotta take that sentimental journey. Sentimental journey home.
Ben! We're going to go out now.
Where?
We're going to go for a picnic in the car.
What?
Since we came back from 1940s, house life is better. And we do lots of things like own picnics and out of theatres.
I think it's brought us closer together because we were known for arguments, whereas we do tend to listen to each other more.
Apart from making Granny go bonkers, the 1940s experience has made her more relaxed.
Off the complete series, the 1940s highest priced $19.99 will be available from the 5th of February. And next Thursday on 4, look out for a 1900 highest 1 hour special at 8 o'clock. And if you'd like to take part in the next Channel 4 highest project, we'll have details in just a moment.